Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Merhaba, everybody. We're coming to the end of Ramadan, and it is always a little bit a melancholic moment, right? Because when you have the experience of fasting, you find that when the Ramadan lands, is coming to an end, there's this certain energy which is there during the Ramadan is disappearing. And it would be actually interesting to try to find a proof in the matrix that there must be a certain field appearing in that time. I would not have any other explanation how it should work, that every year it is the same effect. There is this happiness coming and increasing, and it has a kind of peak point, and then it slowly starts to decrease again. However, we found it out that fasting gives you one thing, and this is time. And time is one of the most fascinating things we can look at in our life. Time is, first of all, one of the highest reflections to our life. When we forget about time, when we do not understand that there is something divine in the time, we miss something. And I think I was mentioning it one time before, that you need to have satisfaction in your life. Joy is one point. Satisfaction is even a higher level. So when you do anything, it doesn't matter what you do. You can do gardening, you can do painting, you can do music, you can do cooking. If you do it with a lot of attention, with all your care, with all your heart, let's say, you find naturally a satisfaction into it, right? But for most of your life, you miss that satisfaction. And this is a sign that you miss time, that you are not in the right time. And we mentioned it before, there is a title that a master receives in Sufism, and this title is Sahib-e-Zaman, which means he becomes the master of time. And I remember very much every time I was coming to the place of Maulana where he lived or where he stayed, the field he had around himself had a lot to do with the feeling how time passes in this field. And one thing I felt always there is that everything goes in the right rhythm there, in the right time. Every day was just exactly as it had to be. And this was, once I started to become aware of it, was always puzzling me how it can be, how he does it, you know, or how it happens. Because it seemed like this field is completely tolerant about any person who enters. It would always affect anybody, no matter which kind of character, which kind of temperament, everyone would be affected by that field. And so I remember one time a story Maulana told us, that there has been a Sufi master, and he asked his murids. He was not a very famous one. He was, let's say, he was the master of his village. No, and in old times, it used to be that every village would have such a person, which doesn't mean that these people were small ones or low ranked, let's say, in their state. It might be even the opposite. Some of them could be very, very high, but they were just not interested in any way to become popular or to become known for very good reasons. We call them also the hidden ones. And this story is from one of those hidden ones, because also Maulana said he surely had a name, but no one knows it. But we know this one story from him. And in this story, he was sitting with his murids, and he asked his murids, why do people scream? What is the reason for them to scream? So one murid said, well, Sheikh, they are desperate, and so they feel this pressure, and so they scream. And he said, yes, well, this is what is the effect. No, this is what drives them. But what is the origin of it? No. And so the other one said, well, they may have fear, or the thing. He said, not bad, but it is not the thing. No. And so he said, when someone screams, he takes a great distance from his heart, and he cannot hear himself anymore. And the more he screams, the louder he becomes, the more distant he becomes with his own heart. And when he comes back and you go in the opposite direction, you come closer and closer, and let's say you become intimate, you start very often to whisper when you are intimate with somebody, when you are very close to somebody. You do not raise your voice, right? So, when someone screams, and you also scream as a reaction, both will feel very sad afterwards because they have distant in their heart. And Maulana often said, it is worse to scream at your child than to beat it. And many of the Westerners especially, they would not understand it, because screaming is a very normal thing in all the families. But in the Orient, it is not like that. In the Orient, screaming is an absolute exception. So, and there is a golden rule in the marriage, in our tradition, and this is, you never scream in front of your children. And honestly, in all the families I have been, I have never heard the couple screaming in front of the children. They were definitely fighting with each other, but they did never do it in front of their children. So I liked very much this story that Maulana said. And when I listened to it the first time, it touched me very deep, because as many of us, we screamed a lot in our life. And Maulana said also, when you scream, it's like you rob something from yourself. You steal something from yourself. And I found it in my life very true. And the opposite is also true. When you become silent, you give something to yourself. You add something. And many masters choose to be silent in their life. And there is many advantages, because silence can do a lot of things to you. First thing it does, it reduces the amount of trouble in your life. When you have a lot of trouble, let's say you are really in the pressure pot, then try that out. Try to fast from speaking. Make a 3 days fasting. Put a badge on your clothes and say, I'm in the mode of not speaking, so people don't have to question anything. And then look what happens to you. I did one time in my life, a 3 months fasting of speaking. And it was one of the strongest experiences I had. Because when you stop speaking, it doesn't mean you stop necessarily thinking. But there is an effect from your tongue to your mind and to your heart. When the tongue stops, when this expression stops, some thoughts some emotions also start to fade out. And in fact, I found it extremely difficult to come back speaking. It was almost a torturing experience to come back speaking. And if there would have been a way that I could stay in silence, I would have kept it. I could stay in silence for 3 months because I was living in India at that time in the Himalaya in a remote area, and I had practically no social life there. I was not married, I was not having children, I didn't have a profession in that time. So it was a beautiful occasion. And the beginning also was hard. It was not easy, but in time it became better and better. So these things, the way we use our mouth, the way we use our voice, is much more important than what you think. And for this reason, one of the closest companions to the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and his successor, his first successor, also the founder of our line, the Naqshbandi line, Abu Bakr Siddiq, he used to put a stone in his mouth so that he would not be able to just speak spontaneously. He could not speak really with that stone in the mouth. And once Malana told us that he has that stone, that he got it through the silsila of our tariqat, that stone was always given to the next grand sheikh, and that's the way it reached to him. So even you make fasting from speech 1 hour, 2 hours, if you make that a habit to yourself, that you do not speak intentive with intention, then look what will happen in that time. Yeah. How you feel, how you think. I wish you a very blessed Eid for those who had performed Ramadan. And if you want to bring it to the top, to the full expansion, then also do the 6 days of Shawwal, which are very highly recommended. This will be much more of an effort than the fasting in Ramadan, but effort is needed. In the stage most of people are. So have a blessed Eid, Eid Mubarak for you. And thank you, thank you, thank you very much. May all of you are blessed. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Hear you soon again.